Hello, the Consulate General of Greece in Los Angeles, along with the Consulate General of Greece in San Francisco, John Vlachogiannis, and members of the Greek startup community in the West Coast, are happy to present to you our initiative, Learn from the Greeks. During these very difficult times that we are all facing together, we thought that we should offer you something entertaining and informative. Therefore, we partnered with Greeks, successful Greeks, all of them in their field, who will be presenting to you who they are, what they have done, and will be giving you tips in order to follow in their path. I honestly hope that you will support our initiative and that you will enjoy the videos. Thank you.
Welcome to Learn from the Greeks. My name is Daphne Vitsikunaki, and I'm the trade officer at the Greek Consulate in San Francisco. Learn from the Greeks is, as you can see, is a video series that is aimed at bringing you closer to Greece and Greece closer to you. It is my great pleasure to welcome today's guests. He is an accomplished scientist and a very successful entrepreneur, Dimitrios Iliopoulos. Dimitri, welcome. And please introduce yourself and talk to us a bit about your professional journey and your personal path. Thank you.
Oh, first of all, thank you very much for the invitation. It's a great pleasure for me to be here and be part of this series, Learn from the Greeks. As you said, I'm Dimitris. I'm a co-founder and CEO of Pathos Therapeutics, a biotech platform company located in Los Angeles, in California, and developing novel drugs for patients with autoimmune diseases. I'm married with Alexandra Drakaki, who is from Crete. She's a professor of oncology at UCLA, and we have three nice daughters, Marilena, Hara, and Adonia.
Now,
I grew up in Volos. I have studied biology and genetics in the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. I came in the United States and specifically in Philadelphia for my PhD studies in cancer biology. And after I graduated, I moved to Harvard Medical School to perform my postdoctoral fellowship on the field of drug development and inflammation. We're also there in Boston. I started my academic career as an assistant professor of immunology and microbiology, again at Harvard Medical School. 2012, I moved from Boston to Los Angeles and founded the first Center for Systems Biomedicine at UCLA, which is a high technology center focused on the development of novel therapeutics for different human diseases, including cancer and inflammatory diseases. At the same time, I got my MBA degree from my UCLA School of Management. I immersed my passion on data analysis with finance and biotechnology, and also I wrote a book named Biotech Evaluation and Investing, which became a very successful book and has a lot of sales in, through Amazon. Now, a few years ago, I have decided to move from academia, that I have spent the majority of my life, to the biotech and pharma sector, because I want to see that my discoveries are able to move from the laboratory to patients and translate to new therapeutics. So currently I'm involved in different efforts and I have co-founded three different companies. The first one is, as I said, Atho Therapeutics that I founded here in Los Angeles with two professors coming from UCLA, Dr. Alan Panduk and Dr. Michael Zhang. And in this company, there are several Greeks actually in leadership positions. The second company is called Diania Health, coming from the Greek word Diania. And also I co-founded this company with Irene Schlosser, who is a great Greek entrepreneur also. And this is a digital health artificial intelligence company that has a computational platform that expedites the process of matching patients with clinical trials and novel therapeutics. And the third company that I have founded is called Attica Sciences. I started this company with my business partner, Mr. Anagnostou. It is located in Athens, in Greece, and focuses on both developing preventative and therapeutic drugs for different diseases derived from ancient Greek herbs and olive oil and mastic gum. And we will discuss more also later about that. So overall, I'm involved in different aspects of drug discovery, development, as I said again, aiming to develop innovative therapies for different human diseases.
Fantastic stuff, Dimitris, and especially this third company you are referring to. This is very close to my heart as a trade officer. All our trade offices in all our embassies and consulates around the world are helping and supporting Greek companies who export their products to the international market. So promotion of olive oil and mastika is at the forefront of our activities. But let me go back to the fact that you have managed to successfully secure funding for not only one, but three startup companies. And also you mentioned your book, where I believe you you talk about attracting investments. So this leads me to my question. How can someone successfully prepare to pitch an idea to investors? Maybe also this is really interesting to our viewers who are in the startup community.
Well, thank you. Yeah, this is a great question. And pitching is the first step and the most actually important step starting the process of setting up a company and getting the company funded. Now, pitching is not a simple process, and my advice to new entrepreneurs is that they have to spend a lot of time and work on their pitch deck actually for months before they plan to present in front of potential investors. Now, the main tool is the slide deck that we call it pitch deck that the founders they have to put together. And an effective pitch deck must keep the investors engaged. It must have a very good flow, and it should be a comprehensive story presented in maximum 15 minutes and having no more than 15 to 20 slides. Now, anyone can put together some slides, but it's important to have in mind that for every 100 pitches that an investor hears, only one gets funded. So it's a very competitive process, and the young entrepreneurs should try to avoid the technical jargon that will confuse their audience. Should stick to simpler words, animation, transitions to convey complicated ideas. And it's very important to create a presentation that even someone with little knowledge in the industry and in the field actually they are able to understand it. Also, angel investors and venture capitalists, they don't want their money to sit on the bank. They want to create high return on investment, the ROI, as we said. And one of the best ways to get their attention is to present clear scenarios and exit strategies for the company. And this will show to the investors that you have done your homework, you are credible, and their money is in good hands. Also, it's important to have some extra information, maybe some extra slides prepared with detailed information that someone can show to the investors if they have a related questions. A question that it is not part of the main slide deck. And the last, and I think the most important part is practice. Like practice again in front of friends, in front of relatives, in front of professionals before your formal presentation, in front of your potential investors.
And in front of the mirror, right?
Correct, yes. you should try to practice it and be ready, as I said, to be able to stick on the time and tell a nice story. I mean, your presentation should be a nice story.
I've watched many pitches since I'm here in Silicon Valley, and not only from Greek companies that have occasionally come here, but in general. And I always admire the speakers who are able to convey their idea clearly, especially in the elevator pitch,
You're right.
So, which is very, very short. So, as you say, preparation is number one to get it perfect.
You're right.
So, I wanted also to ask you the road to successfully founding and leading startups, I'm sure, is also full of setbacks and bumps. And could you tell us a little bit about your personal experience and what did your failures teach you?
Yeah, failures, actually, it's a part of our lives, and we should try to see failures as a stepping stone for further growth. I think we should try, and that's what I have done also in my case, to learn from our mistakes. We should see what we did wrong in the past and how we try to correct it and do it appropriately the next time. I think this is the main lesson that we should learn from our mistakes. Also, it will teach us how to be more courageous, and we know it takes a lot of courage to deal with failure and then to get back in your feet. And as I say, when you have nothing more to lose, you have a lot to gain. So I think people should not be afraid to fail. On a journey of building a company, there are going to be a lot of problems. And as I say, building a company, it's the main effort is to continuously solving problems. As like a CEO and leader in different companies, every day you have different problems that you have to solve to go to the next step. So at the end, of course, you hear very nice success stories, but it's important to hear how people arrived at that point. And definitely, I haven't heard the success story that they didn't have problems or failures during their journey. So I think failure also teaches you in many ways. It saves you as a person. And I think if we can cultivate a stronger relationship with failure, we will be more successful not only at work, but also at different aspects of our lives.
How true, of course. And this goes also for each of us in the personal lives and also in the professional field. So that brings me now to my next question. In these current trying times of the COVID pandemic, how has this affected you affected you as a leader in the startups that you run, but also personally? And in general, what would you say are the opportunities that present themselves in this situation of the pandemic?
So the coronavirus outbreak has affected myself, my family, my businesses, like everyone else. I think it's a very tough period that we have to go through. And we had to adjust in the new reality and try to be productive during this difficult period. Now at work, we had to take all the required precautions of social distancing. Our team members have to work in shifts. And we have to change our meetings that we have weekly in person through Zoom meetings, which is the new normal, I think, of meeting people and discussing. So we have to do all these adjustments in order to be able to move forward. However, as I say, we are Greek, so we try to be creative and try to find something different, how we can actually do something creative during this period and identify new opportunities. And one thing that I would like to mention is related to one of the companies that I'm involved, the Diania Health. And so Diania Health, as I said, it aims to identify patients with cancer or autoimmune diseases and match them to clinical trials that are available all over the world. So it tries to expedite this kind of process that right now it's manual through artificial intelligence. Now, the problem is that during this period, most of these clinical trials have slowed down for multiple reasons during the pandemic. And pharma companies have shifted their interest to COVID-19. So we have to find a solution and be able to continue our activities. So we have brainstormed with the CEO of the company, Irini, our chief technology officer, Chrysanthi Dori, who is another Greek. And We shifted our interest and use our platform and technology actually to match patients with COVID-19 and available therapies and clinical trials in the United States. So we have made a software application that actually is free. It's available in the NS Health website for patients and for the whole community in order to be able to see if, as an individual, if you have a high risk to get the virus. If you get the virus, what is your risk to get hospitalized? And also, if you have the virus, which are the clinical trials in close proximity to your location that actually you could match? So all this information someone can find in our application that I said it's free.
That's amazing. It's not that easy to shift from your main course of activities but we are so grateful as a community globally that many companies do shift to finding solutions or helping in any way fight the COVID. Yeah. The 19 pandemic, as you are referring to with Diania now.
You're right. And as you said, I think for pharmaceutical digital health companies, there have been a lot of new opportunities created during this period. And I think something important for us, like scientists, the community, I think now understands how difficult it is to develop a new drug, what it takes several years to generate like the data and information in order to safely say that the drug is effective to treat the disease. So I think people now, they are more related and they understand more about science. And I think this has helped us to consider and make our jobs easier and actually bring together science and community, which I think it's very important. And there was a big gap up to now. So this pandemic, although it has a lot of negative things, I think it has contributed positively towards this direction.
And if that is true, of course, for drug development, it is twice as true for the vaccine development, isn't it? I mean, in order to have a safe vaccine in place, it's going to take a long time because it's a lengthy process, right?
It's a lengthy process. Usually it takes years to do clinical trials. In the first steps, you have to check if the vaccine is safe to give it to individuals. And after you complete your safety studies, then we move to the efficacy studies to see if the vaccine actually can protect from the disease. Now, right now, the companies, I know they try to do their best. I mean, they bundle all this together in the same trial. So what they do is not what usually we do in drug development. And we don't have the best, let's say, data and complete data set to be definitely sure that we are going to have the best vaccine. However, right now, there are multiple efforts and from big pharma and smaller companies. And I think we're going to have several vaccines ready by the end of the year, and especially at the beginning of 2021.
Let's hope so. Let's hope that a cure, a drug or a vaccine, a drug and a vaccine, get developed very quickly. So allow me to shift now to your current interactions and activities in Greece and to talk to us a little bit more about the company in Greece.
Yeah. So starting, first of all, I will take the opportunity from this question and say that actually in Greece today, it's very attractive for new investments. And in Greece, someone can find the talent needed to set up a highly innovative company, having much lower cost in comparison to countries like the United States. And although there's still space for improvement in the bureaucracy part and in order to start a new company, I think overall the situation have substantially improved. So as I mentioned before, and I founded together with my business partner, Mr. Anagnostou, a highly innovative company in Greece and in Athens called Attica Sciences. Attica is developing novel therapeutics for having a focus primarily on cancer. And this is something that is being done for the first time in a Greek pharmaceutical company. And how we do this? We do this by developing new chemical compounds that they come and they derive from ancient Greek herbs and plus and foods like olive oil and mastika, the mastic gum. Now, Attica research activities, they are performed in Greece and in collaboration with exceptional scientists in the University of Thessaly and the University of Athens in the School of Pharmacy there. And we have assembled an excellent scientific board consisting of different scientists. We have Dr. Konstantinos Drosatos, Dr. Spiros Garbits. Both they are Greeks. They are professors in Temple University and Caltech, very successful scientists in their fields. And one thing that I would like to mention about Attica is that Attica's story, and still it's in the first steps, show the potential of agricultural and medical biotechnology fields in Greece. We discuss about Greece, and I know the easiest domain that we can develop, and there's a lot of action right now, is digital health or bioinformatics, and mainly through the effort that exists in Thessaloniki now with the hub that is being developed there from Pfizer. And this is through another Greek, Albert Bourla, who is the CEO of Pfizer right now. And but I think we have unique, high quality products in Greece, and we should think that this sector will be equally important for Greece's economy, similar to tourism and shipping. It's not a small industry. Both the business side of developing supplements or other programs, or even, as you said, like shipping and exporting olive oil, mastic gum, and other herbs, that they have potential application for prevention of diseases or supporting the immune system. I think we have great products in Greece, and if we look in the US here, there are a lot of products that they are very low quality and even questionable quality, that we have done our search and compare on products that we have in Greece. And the second area is the development of new therapies. And as I said, like Greek nature and even from Asian Greeks, we know that there are a lot of plants that they have this kind of properties. So we have a heritage that we haven't explored, and pharmaceutical industry will be interested to explore more in the scientific level how we can use this knowledge and develop new therapies that they are needed for many human diseases.
Wonderful, yes. Indeed, the Greek nature is has a lot of a lot to give still, and science can help us decode the secrets of the Greek nature and herbs and agricultural products, especially related to health benefits. So, spending your formative, the most of your formative years in Greece and growing up there, tell us about a prominent Greek figure who influenced your career or inspired you.
Yes, I mean, we have many Greek scientists and people that actually from the ancient years that I think they have inspired a lot of people to be on the field of medicine and even drug development. One person that I would like to mention from ancient Greece is like Dioscurides, who is the father of pharmacology and botany. He was a physician, pharmacologist, botanist, and he was author of a book called The Materia Medica, which is actually an encyclopedia about herbal medicine. So this is a book that when I was a kid, we have it in our library, and I was always curious to see like what plants potentially they can have properties and they can have health benefits and therapeutic maybe potential for different diseases. And I was curious how these plants, they can have these properties and how they can help our health and have these benefits. So this book and Dioscurides has played an important role on my way of thinking about the need of developing new therapies, the role that nature and can play to this direction. And also one thing that I remember that what Dioscorides has said, and it's very applicable today, is that nature will never follow people, but people will have to follow the laws of nature. So today we see all this situation, the viruses and the change in the climate, and we understand how important it is to respect nature and that we have to follow the laws of nature and don't try to do whatever we think as humans, ignoring nature, because we are part of this global ecosystem. Which is a group actually of people more recent, and this is related more with my career now and transition from the academia to the biotech, and I mentioned of these persons previously. So it's a group of talented Greeks in the United States in the area of biotechnology and pharma sector who have influenced and inspired my career. People, as I said, like Albert Bourla, who is the CEO of Pfizer, Stelios Papadopoulos, he's the chairman of Biogen, Roy Vagelos, ex-CEO of Merck, George Giancopoulos at Regeneron. All these are leaders, and they lead some of the largest biotech and pharma organizations in the world. And all these are Greeks. And this shows us that if you work hard, then you can create highly innovative companies in the world. You can be a world leader. And these people, they have inspired myself, and I think other also individuals in my generation, to work hard, take risks, be patient in order to be able to build a successful business, and in my case, biotechnology and pharmaceutical companies.
We are so proud of the highly accomplished, outstanding scientists and academics and entrepreneurs who are active in the United States. And as you rightly point out, the example of Pfizer in Thessaloniki, it was made possible by a Greek-American, a member of the Greek diaspora, but no American company would actually make a decision like that if they didn't really see the excellent potential of Greece as an investment destination in this case. So we're very fortunate.
And I think this is an example that we will see in the next couple of years when this hub is established. So Greece has great scientists. Thessaloniki also, the university there, it's a great university. So I think the people there, they are going to do fantastic work. And then people at Pfizer and other pharmaceutical companies, or even other technology companies like Google or Microsoft that they're thinking to do, but they haven't done, I think they're going to move this direction.
We will be very... intrigued to see what other big companies would want to do in Greece. We have recent examples of Greek startup companies being acquired by big American companies, mm-hmm. and these are very promising signs right. for also the startup community in Greece. And to come to my last question, on a lighter note, allow me to ask you, what is your favorite food or wine from Greece?
Yes, I like a lot of Greek foods, and I'm fortunate enough, I'm married to a Greek woman, so that we have a lot of Greek food even here in Los Angeles.
You made the right choice.
Yes. So one of my favorite Greek foods that actually is traditional from my area, it's called spetsofai. And this is a food that a lot of people, they don't know. It's cooked primarily in like Portaria. This is my family village in Mount Pelion in Greece, which is close next to Volos. And this is a food made from Greek sausages and has red and green peppers in tomato sauce. And it's great to combine this food also together with a glass of local tsipouro.
Excellent. You are transporting us to beautiful Pelion. It's really a wonderful experience to have spetsofai while in Portaria, but also here. Well, Thank you so much, Dimitri, for being our guest today. And thank you to our audience. And we will be back with another episode of Learn for the Greek soon. So thank you, stay safe, and stay tuned.
Thank you.